All right, praise God. There's our pastor. He's here. He's ready to go. God bless. All the children of the Lord. We're going to say amen to our pastor.
Of joy, of gladness, and we're speaking about the Word of God now, because we believe that the Word of God, if we all get back to the Word, how many will admit that you've gotten away from the Word?
Amen.
I mean, we got to get back to the Word and start going, reading the Word so that we can have that joy and that mind to do what God has commanded us to do. Let me just pray, because I want to share some things that will really help you. I'm really concerned about our commitment to the Word. When I said the Word, I mean personal Bible study. How many can read pretty good? How many can read pretty good? Okay, well, we just have to make time in our schedule. To what? To give to the Word of God. I know that I was sick. I wasn't able to do all our reading, and my mind wasn't there, and my energy just wasn't there, and I just couldn't actually grasp a whole lot of things. But I could pray, and the Lord restored my strength. How many been there when you like were fasting? I was like a 6 weeks fast. It's almost like that. I could have gone every day without eating anything. I just didn't have a desire to eat. But most times I was forced to eat a little bit, and I was just kind of, amen, sometimes just pacifies Miss Hill. Because she wants to see me eat, and I didn't feel like I wanted to eat. Amen. But what happened is that after that consecration, 6 weeks, I guess, I just didn't stay away from food. The anointing really have been restored, and the desire for the hunger for the Word. The hunger for the Word. I guess it's the result of a lack of fast, a long fast. You really kind of get in a mode where the Word of God takes on a different meaning, and you develop a hunger that you haven't had before. So maybe some of you might need to fast a few days. Scripture says, man shall not live by what? Bread alone, but by every word. So I'm going to pray that the Lord will just kind of lead us, because I think it will be good for us to kind of abstain for a few days, so that the things of the flesh, and as Bible says, the cares of life, the deceitfulness of riches and the lust of other things, these things will begin to die out in our lives, and the things of God will begin to surface again. So I'm really admonishing you to get back into the Word of God. I just got back just to read. I just started the book of Matthew. And also, I was motivated to read the book of Jeremiah, because I feel like something is growing worldwide. And I think that we ought to be aware that God is really speaking through a whole lot of the political things, worldwide events, and things that's happening all over the world. God is really speaking. And I think at the time is very, very, very near. And the Lord just motivated me to read the book of Jeremiah, and I just started reading the book of Matthew, or reading the whole New Testament, this whole book. I'm kind of reading in like the book of Acts, and I'm just picking out certain books that I would read every day. And I just want to see you with the hunger for the Word of God again, a hunger. Amen. The scripture says that, I think we shared this a few Sundays ago, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners will be converted unto thee. So, see, our main objective, our main assignment, our main call is to carry out the will of God, and to do what Jesus would do if he were here on the earth. So I'm just going to pray, and I'm just going to just share with you, because I feel like back to the Word. I mean, this is something that you have to do. You can do 3 chapters a day. You might want to, I mean, that book of Acts, boy, I'm belongs, and this is what I'm supposed to be doing. This is where my head should be. This is where my motivation should be. This is what every believer should be doing. In that book, you see everybody had soul-saving ministry. Everybody had a miracle ministry. Everybody had a healing ministry. Amen. And so we're not here to...
But we are here for a specific purpose, and I want to admonish you that we need to get back to the foundation and the thing that God has called us to do.
I hope this one is over. Okay. All right, so let me just have a word of prayer, and I'm going to get started. Father, we thank you for your grace. Your grace is sufficient, and you're able to cause all grace to abound toward us, so we will have sufficiency in everything. Father, we give you praise. We give you the glory. In Jesus' name. Everybody just say, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I want to start with something that you've heard before. And this is the basics of our existence, I guess, as believers here. We're here just for a period of time. We call it a time-leased dominion. And that period of time will end for us as we are all believers and Christians when Jesus comes back for us, or when we stand before God. That period will be over. Amen. So this time lease that God has given us is a period of time that God is testing us, or placing us on probation. So that's the reason why we really, really need to be concerned about what we're doing. We're on probation, and we have been tested to see if we will obey the word. Know how we obey, the extent that we obey. I know some just do so much, and some just do what they feel like they want to do, and some don't do hardly anything. But this time frame, that's the reason why we're going to be judged as to how we use and how we spend our time. Because the test of probation that we are on will determine if we will be counted worthy of eternal responsibility in connection with the earth and God's kingdom. This is the test and probation that all believers are on. Of course, the unbelievers don't have this to look for, because they will not experience God's kingdom, and they will not reign with Christ during the millennium and live with him from that point on. So the time frame that God has given all of us, and most of us have been saved for a period of time, and but God will determine whether you will be accounted worthy to assume responsibilities, whether you can be trusted with important assignments and duties throughout eternity. If you don't do it here, if you don't be faithful here, if you have to do it here, if you don't do it at all here, then you're going to fail the test. The test, you're not going to fail. See, we only have one time, one opportunity, and this is going to be the time that you be back saved. Amen. Until the time that you go to meet the Lord. During that period of time, I mean, just think about that. That period of time, you're going to be scrutinized by God to see if you're going to obey, whether you will obey and serve him willingly. Amen. See, probation is a testing or a trial for a period of time to determine a person's nature. Amen. A person's nature, personality, and character. Boy, we see a whole lot of personality, characters, and I mean, a lot of that comes out in the wash, doesn't it? Y'all know it, it comes out in the wash. But God is testing or trying us for a period of time to determine a person's nature, personality, and character. So if we can see each other's nature, personality, and character, how much more God is taking note. And He knows exactly who we are and what we're all about. Yes. Amen. Now, this is God's way to ascertain whether a man will serve Him willingly. So the probation, amen. Everybody just said, I'm in probation now. I'm being tested. So that's the reason why you need to be thinking about what you're doing. You know, all of these opportunities you're missing to know the Word and to be a lot more effective and to help a whole lot more people. See, the Bible says all doctrine is given, all of the Bible is what? Given for doctrine, reproof, correction, and instructions in what? In righteousness. So that the man of God might be what? Thoroughly furnished unto all good works. See, how are you going to explain to God that you went through life, amen, half furnished? I mean, you could have gotten a whole lot more information. You could have been in a position to help a whole lot more people. Even if you were, amen, would have what? You know, some of this fleshly thing, sometimes people have reasons why they don't support stuff. I don't like Sister Kim. Well, I haven't heard anybody say that. Well, in that class, they have too much information. I mean, you have to read too much. And sometimes people do stuff like that because it's going to require, you know, anything else we want to. I'm not fussing today. Well, I wish I could fuss a little bit sometimes. Anything else we want to do, we take time and do it, right? And then why can't we take time and do things that will what? Build us up. That will equip us. See, every effort that we put forward should be directed toward doing things that will cause us to fulfill our responsibility and to be in a position where we can respond favorably to God when we meet Him face to face, even at the judgment seat of Christ. Because you're going to have to give an account, amen, of every deed, every word God is going to bring into judgment. Every word, along with every secret thing, He's going to bring it all into judgment. Amen. So what I'm saying is that our primary motivation should be, what can I do? What commitment do I need to make? And what sacrifices that I really need to make in order to be more efficient, to be more effective, amen, and to be more better positioned, to actually carry out the will of God, because the Bible says that we are ambassadors and we are workers together with Him. And we have our grave responsibility. I mean, we're going to have to face it all when the judgment takes place. Of course, there will be more than one judgment. There will be a judgment in which you will be scrutinized and you will be assigned eternal responsibilities. And then, of course, the Bible says some will just make it in by the skin of their teeth. Everybody is not going to be rewarded for the works that they've done down here, because the works that we do down here, it has to be a certain quality. It has to be works that perform in the spirit, works that perform in obedience, and the works that are works that will what? Be done for the to glorify the Lord. I mean, there's a certain caliber of works that you're going to be rewarded for. So that's the motivation. Now, if none of the works that you do really meet the criteria, and you are still naked by the skin of your teeth, that means that what? You will have no works Amen. To present to the Lord, and I don't see how you could be a parent worthy to assume any eternal responsibilities. Of course, they might have places where maybe you can sweep the streets or something like that. I'm just kidding. Maybe, but we're going to be paid according to our works. Amen. So that's the whole thing behind our obedience and the fitness to serve God through our eternity without sin and rebellion. Okay, so eventually that's what will happen. We will be able to serve God throughout eternity without sin and without rebellion. Amen. How many want to be counted in that number? Amen. So I just wanted to just give you some of the areas that God is going to definitely call our attention to. And number one, what specifically will believers' judgment or examination be based on? And let me just do number one, faithfulness in the use of the opportunities, talents and abilities, and pounds, which would be the money entrusted to them. So these are the things that God is going to bring into judgment. When you face God, amen, this is going to happen after we are called to be with the Lord. Amen. After Jesus comes and we are taken to heaven, translated into heaven, amen, this is the thing that we're going to face. We're going to face the judgment seat of Christ. Everybody say it, the judgment seat of Christ. Amen. And so faithfulness in the use of your opportunities. All right. Now, that's something you need to think about. Yeah. What are you doing with the opportunities that you have in terms of your time, your talents, your abilities, your money? All of these things, God count very, very important, because you're on a timely dimension. You're just here for a period of time. And after that, God is just going to what? He's just going to what? He will determine, amen, exactly how you carried out your assignment, how you related, how you treated the things that he gave you. Amen. All of these things are for the glory of God. God wants to be what? Glorified, and he wants to be what? He wants to be magnified. Now, Ephesians 5:16, just turn there. This scripture is a scripture. I'm going to read that. Says, redeeming the time. Okay, let me do verse 14. Wherefore he said, awake, thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as what? Wise. Redeeming the time, because the days are what? Evil. Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. Be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting yourselves one to another in the fear of God. That's Tuesday night. Submitting yourself to one another in the fear of God. Your leaders, people that's trying to get God's program established and people blessed and people ministered to, you have to submit to that. So what I'm saying here is that these verses that I just read, these are verses that describe what you should be doing right now as believers. And sometimes we just go right over this and we just don't, you know, take it at heart at all. All right? So all of this is impossible without you being involved in the Word of God. So you need to be involved personally. You need to read. And then stop watching television so much. And what? Take out your Bible. Most times we blow enough time and do things that we don't have to do. Amen. And which what deprives us of what? The opportunity sometimes to spend quality time in the Word of God. And we need to spend quality time. Amen. How many are facing stuff, going through things, and you constantly being challenged? All right, stay in the Word. Amen. Praise God. Stay in the Word, and maybe a lot of this stuff could be averted. Amen. So let's spend quality. Everybody say quality time.
Quality time.
Y'all know what I mean by quality time. That means when you get up in the morning, the first opportunity that you have, take out your Bible and read it for a while. Okay? Read a little bit in Matthew, maybe. You might want to do that. Read a little bit in the book of Acts. You might want to read a little bit in Psalms. And some have a systematic approach in which they just go through the entire Bible in a period of a year's time. Now, how the Bible says, study to show yourselves approved unto God, a what? Workman. That what? Needed not to be what? Ashamed. Amen. So we need to be full of the Holy Ghost. That's what the scripture says. What? Be filled with the Spirit. And that's how we get filled with the Spirit. We what? Amen. We got to start with the Word. How many can say amen?
Amen?
Spend time and then try to take advantage of all of the opportunities that you have at your church to get the Word established in your life. Because your mind needs to be what? Renewed by the Word of God. Amen. Let me just turn over to 1 Timothy. I'm just doing this today because the Lord directed me to do it. Okay, but that judgment, the first thing that I have on my list here is what did you do with the opportunities that you had to build yourself up and to get established and to be a light, to be an example, or to fulfill the role that God has called you to do. You have a purpose here. Bible says we must work while it is day. For when night cometh, what? No man can work. If we spend all of our time just doing frivolous things and getting involved with the cares of life, the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things, amen, the Word is going to be what? Drained out of us. Amen. All right, let me turn to this scripture. 1 Timothy 4. I'm just going as the Lord leads me today because I think this is the best thing that I can do today. Okay, 1 Timothy 4, it says this, 4:12, these things command and teach. Okay, that's what I'm doing. I'm commanding and I'm teaching. This is 4:11. Let no man despise thy youth, but be thou an example of the believers in word, in conversation, in charity, in spirit, in faith, in purity. I mean, believers in word. Be thou an example of the believers in word. In other words, you got to what? You got to know the Word. You got to spend time in the Word. You got to be impacted by the Word so that you can come to the point where you can be what? Guided and motivated and moved by what? The Holy Ghost. Bible said we the circumcision, we are to what? Worship God in spirit, not in our flesh. God is not pleased with even our worship when it's just so so toned down until amen, hardly nobody can hear it. Amen. How many just worship so low? So low that nobody else can hear. Let no man despise thy youth, be thou an example of the believers in what? Word. You ought to be a believer. If you say you know the Lord and you've been saved, you've been spirit filled, you ought to be in a position to what? To help people and to guide them and to minister to them. We ought to be consistently, everybody just said consistently, consistently what? Ministering to people, amen, that do not know the word like you know it. I know this is falling on deaf ears today. In word, in conversation, that means lifestyle. In what? Charity. In spirit, in faith, in purity. Okay? Let's go on. Till I come. See, this is what it means to be an example of a believer. And this is what God will be judging us on. All of these things here will come into play. Till I come, give attendance to reading. All right, this is what the apostle was commanded. He said, till I come, give attendance to what? Reading. To what? Exhortation. To doctrine. So it's good for us to exhort one another. Many times when we have opportunities, amen, nobody got anything to say. Amen. So I think that if the word of God is really working mightily in you, I think that you ought to have something that you want to exhort somebody with. Amen. Sometime. Probably can say amen. Amen. All right. To exhortation to what? Doctrine. Neglect not the gift that is in thee. All right. I'm going to read that again. Neglect not the gift that is in thee. You know, a whole lot of us will be in trouble because we haven't done anything with our gifts. How many got a gift in here? So that's all. I got a gift for talking, you know? You got a gift for gabbing. You're going to be talking to the people about their souls. That's a plus if you use it in the right way. Is that right? Which was given thee by prophecy with the laying on of hands of the presbytery. All right, meditate upon these things. All right, meditate, meditate, meditate. Bible says that we are to be primarily given over to meditating what? Day and night. Amen. Meditate upon these things. Give thyself wholly to them that thy profiting may appear to what? All. Amen. See, people need to know that it's profitable for you to make the sacrifices and for you to make the commitments you make and for you to know the Lord Jesus, amen, as you know him. Amen. Somebody used to say this. They said, I'm going to believe in your Redeemer. You're going to have to look more redeemed yourself. If I'm going to believe in your Redeemer, you're going to have to look more. You know, people need to see that there's a difference in people that believe and don't believe. And everything is based on what? What are you doing with the Word of God? How committed you are what? On a daily basis. Amen. I know we're going to have a whole lot of Bible open in the morning. I don't mean just read a verse or two just to pacify your mind. I mean just get in the Word and what? And just read a whole chapter at a time. Two chapters. Amen. You can watch TV, amen, for 30 minutes, an hour straight. Something's wrong when you can't what? When the Word of God doesn't have what? The same drawing power, attraction as what? Even TV. Amen. How many are gonna do that? Well, I'm not fussing together. But we in serious trouble. Y'all know how this world is what it's leading to. Y'all know that something catastrophic could happen what? Any time. We could be in judgment at what? Any time. Destruction at any time. Amen. Jesus can come what? Any day. How many can say amen? Amen. We might face the judgment seat of Christ what? Any time. And we're going to have to give an account. Bible says, be not deceived, God is not mocked, whatever we sow, we're going to want to reap. They say, let us say the conclusion of a whole matter, fear God, keep his commandments. Because he's going to bring every word into judgment along with every secret thing. If God is going to bring everything that we do into judgment, along with every secret thing, that means that we ought to be kind of what, concerned about what we do or what we don't do. Is that right?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes.
How many want to make a diligent effort to get back into the Word of God? Most of y'all read it good enough to read 3 chapters a day. You need to read what Jesus said, because that's what you're going to be judged by. God has, amen, has already said, amen, that I'm not going to judge you. Amen. He said this. He said, I'm going to what? Relegate that responsibility to my son, Jesus. Jesus is the one that God say, amen, will judge, but Jesus will, that responsibility has been relegated to him because he can sympathize with us, amen, more than somebody that have never what? Walked in the flesh. The Bible says he was tempted as we are, yet without what? Sin.
Yes.
Then he knows how to what? Succor or deliver them that are tempted. So Jesus can relate to what you're going through. So he's gonna, I mean, he's down on a level. He's been down there. He knows, amen, about temptation. But the Bible says he committed no sin, neither was what? Guile found in his mouth. So Jesus knows, amen, the limitations of your flesh. So he's the one that God has assigned this test. So he has to judge. But Jesus said, no, I don't want to judge either. You know, Jesus is so compassionate. I don't want to judge either. He said, I'm going to what? I'm going to relegate all judgment to the Word. Amen. Everything is not God. It's not going to be God judging. It's not going to be Jesus judging. But the Word that they have spoken, that's what you're going to be judged by. And you don't want to read it and find out what it is? You don't want to read it so that you can what? Amen. Who's that said that I found the Word and I ate thereof and it became the joy and the rejoicing of my heart? Who said that? Jeremiah. Jeremiah 15:16. See, that's how you get joy and motivation to do what God says to do. You read the Word. The Word will what? Quicken you. Make you alive. Give you what? Amen. Cause you to run what? Rejoice. Amen. Give you strength. The joy of the Lord will be your what? Strength. So I better, amen, get back up here. I just felt like I should. Okay. Did I finish that? Take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue. Continue in them. All right. Continue in them. Now, when you begin to read doctrines, things that Jesus spoke, very important that you, amen, you read that and understand what Jesus is saying. Amen. Boy, the Bible says, desire the sincere men of the Word of God that you might what? Grow thereby. You need to be, all of us need to be reading the Word of God. You have to do it over and over and over. How many know that you have a tendency to forget? I don't know what percent of Bible that you learn. Probably 90%. You have to read it over. How many can say amen? Over and over and over and over. And then the book of Acts, you need to know what you need to be doing. The attitude and the disposition towards the work of God. Amen. So I really began to, after I was out for over a month, I said, I need to get back in the book of Acts. I need to be revitalized, rejuvenated, because I need to, amen, really began to develop more of a concern about souls.
Yeah.
That's the thing that really hit me. Amen. After 6 weeks, it just seemed like I was in a dream. Amen. But when I came to my sense, the Lord said, get back in the Word.
Yes.
Amen. And really began to what? See. Amen. What I'm calling you to do. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
All right. Now look at that. Continue in them, for in doing this thou shalt both save thyself and them that what? Hear thee. Amen. So you can see the importance of taking heed and continuing in them, because in doing this thou shalt save both yourself, thyself, and them that hear thee. Okay, over in 2 Timothy, I want you to turn to there. It says this, 2 Timothy, this is 2 Timothy 4, I believe. Second Timothy 3, I'm sorry. All right, this is the 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter, and the 13th verse. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But continue thou in the things, okay? But continue. Continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto what? Salvation through what? Faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Alright, so the Scriptures are designed to make you what? Wise. Whatever abilities and strengths you don't have, the Holy Scripture, amen, is designed to what? To equip you so that you will be able to minister on a level where it will be acceptable to God. All right, it says that until salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is given by what? Inspiration of God, and is what? Profitable for what? Doctrine? For reproof? For what? Correction? For instruction in righteousness. How many need doctrine? Doctrine means what? At least it will what? Give you some type of what? Standard or goal. You'll know what you're supposed to do. For reproof, that means that if you're off track, you'll have to what? Get you back. For correction, for instruction in what? Righteousness. That the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Okay. Now, back to last week, I think I gave you this scripture. I'm not going to belabor this, but this really was a summary of the word, the law. This is Psalms 19. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. This is Psalms 19:7. The law is the law. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. How many know that convert the soul means what? Amen. That renewing your mind. So you can make the right decisions, the right choices. Amen. Your thinking can be right, and you won't be dishonoring God in the realm of your mind. So, right? The law of the Lord is perfect. Now, if the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul, who would want to read it? Who would want to take time? I mean, that's the most important thing you could ever do. I mean, your profiting is going to appear to what? To everybody. I mean, people are going to see that you are what? You are profiting. Your life is being what? Blessed. All right? Converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. Amen. This is the word. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. Amen. So that's how you get that spirit of rejoicing. The Bible is designed, amen, to rejoice the heart because the statutes of the Lord are right. Okay? The commandments of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. All right? More to be desired. All right? Now, this is where your will come into play. More to be desired are they than what? Gold. Yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than what? Honey. And the honeycomb. In other words, it's the most important thing in your life. And sometimes you don't have a clue, amen, as to what's most important. Amen. The word of the Lord, amen, is the thing that will make you wise unto salvation. Alright, moreover by them is thy servant warned, and in keeping of them there is great what? There is great reward. Alright, say amen. Alright, right, so faithfulness is the use of opportunities that's being your time, talents, and abilities. Amen. Because what you do with your time and how you spend your time and how you spend your money, all of this will come to play in judgment. Amen. And now we know about the pounds, you know, that parable, that those people that were given the pounds, they were judged according to how they would use their talents, how they use their time, how they use their abilities. And some were placed over a whole lot more than the others. Some had authorities over what? 10 cities. Those that were given 5. Those that were given 2 had authority over 5. The one that didn't use their talent, how much authority was he given? Amen. He wasn't given any. He was a castaway. He was cast into what? Outer darkness. All right, so everybody said faithfulness in the use of opportunities, talents, abilities. Now turn to somebody and say, what are you doing with your abilities? You better, I say home with my abilities. Not nobody. When they had the women's meeting, I don't even know. They had the once per month, but what? I don't want to go to that, but all that stuff they do, it's no more than an hour or so. All right, Sunday school is about an hour. Wednesday night is about what, an hour and a half? Right? Sometimes shorter than that. But we spend our time doing things that's not going to profit us. And one day, some of us going to be what? Sad, sad, sad. The only thing that we have to show, some ashes. Amen. We won't have any works to show. No crowns to what? Display. All we will have is what the Bible says. Amen. Praise God. Ashes. The works will be what? Burned. All right. How many can say amen? Luke 16, 10, 12. I'm going to make this. Now, this is actuality. If Jesus came today, as I don't know at what point, very shortly after you are called into judgment, these are the kind of things that God is going to what, judge you on. These are the things that's going to be coming into play. All right, Luke 16, 10 through 12. Let me just read that. 16, 10. He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much, and he that is unjust in the least is also unjust also in much. If therefore you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? Now this is speaking more of mammon, which would be our riches, our money. So God is going to hold us accountable as to how truthful we were, and how honest we were, and how committed we were, and how faithful we have been in the use of our what? Money. All right, so it's your money. Everybody said money.
Money.
It's my time. And my what? Ability. Those are the things that God is going to bring into play in terms of the opportunities that you have had to glorify Him or to make things better for people that you have been around and people that you could impact and people that you have, been connected with. And many times we have avoided or aborted all of those opportunities, and we will, you know, be in the position of not being able to receive the just recompense of reward. All right, now, the second area, the commitment to our responsibility for the souls of others and how instrumental we were in winning souls. But my time is almost up. Ezekiel 3:18, we have to read these things sometimes over and over. Ezekiel 3:18, well, it's my time up. 3:18. My time is up. I'm just pointing just to two areas, and these are areas that we could actually do something about, because God is sending people all around us. In this church, many times we have a lot of visitors, and many times because the passion is not there, and the interest is not there, and the word in us is not at a certain level, many times we just are not motivated to reach out to people and make a commitment to really develop relationships with them. All right, 3:18. All right. When I say unto the wicked, thou shalt surely die, and thou givest him not warning. Thou speakest, nor speakest to warn the wicked from his wicked way to save his life. The same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require in thy hand. So that shows that God is holding you accountable for the people around you that you can what? Speak to. That you can what? Warn. You can tell about the Lord. You can give your testimony. You can do something to what? Impact them for the kingdom of God. God is holding you what? Accountable for that. And it will come up definitely in judgment, because the Bible mentions about the person that wins souls are going to get a crown of rejoicing. Okay, I'm not done yet. Yet, if thou warn the wicked, and he turn not from his wickedness, nor from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity. But thou as the living, thy what? Soul. Amen. That means what? Time. It means what? Ability. You have to what? Really spend some time. You know, in the word, in prayer, if you do the basic things, more than likely you would be in a position, amen, to really help a lot more people. Amen. So, when a righteous man, am I right now?
Yes.
Again, when a righteous man doth turn from his righteousness and commit iniquity, and I lay a stumbling block before him, he shall what? Die. Because thou hast not given him warning, he shall die in his sin. So that means that righteous people commit iniquity. People that don't come to church, they don't maintain their fellowship with the Lord, and you don't warn them, you don't talk with them, they will die in their sins, and all of the righteousness which he hath done shall not be what? Remembered. But his blood will I require and what? Thy hand. Nevertheless, if thou warn the righteous man that the righteous sin not, and that's the reason why we need to consistently be in fellowship. That's the time for us to exhort one another. Tuesday nights, once per month, Wednesday night, weekly, Sunday morning. I know something comes out in those classes that really encourage people to keep on what? Living for God. And you're not a part of it? Oh, I bless y'all. But I know that most of us like to follow the line of least resistance. Least resistance means what? For rivers, rivers that follow the line of least resistance get crooked. And people that try to what? Do as little as they can. No sacrifices. Alright, no sacrifices. Nothing that will what? Amen. Build them up and make them strong and bring out the best. I know, you know, my sister Hill, I model. She'd be up 3 or 4 o'clock sometimes, working those lessons out. I said, how many do you have tonight? 7. Ain't that sad? I mean, all of those scores of hours. 7. Well, I'm gonna go. Okay, Daniel 12:3. That's the last one. Daniel 12:3. Alright, Daniel 12:3. So the same thing that we're stressing about Tuesday night, once the night we're stressing about Sunday school. Because if we were having evening service Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, I can understand. All right, Daniel 12:3, and they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn men to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. Amen. That's the reward that one receives when they turn many to righteousness. Amen. According to the scripture, Daniel 12:3. They that be wise. And we just have to read it. Wisdom comes through what? The scripture. Wisdom comes through the scripture. The Bible says that the interest of thy word giveth what? Light, it giveth what? Understanding to the simple. All right, so those two are the two areas, faithfulness and the use of opportunities, and the commitment to our responsibility for the souls of others, and how instrumental we were in what winning souls. Amen. Y'all want to hear the rest of them? Are you waiting until the next time? All right, hospitality and kindness shown to the needy. All right, those who effectively control their flesh and succeed in overcoming sin, the works of the flesh, and Satan. Boy, that's some high requirements, but all of it comes through the Word. Faithfulness of pastors and leaders who have an oversight over God's people. And how we run that particular race which God has chosen for us. Amen. These are other things that God will bring into judgment. That is the reason why we have been preaching as we are about knowing who we are in Christ. Because if we don't get a revelation of that, we just feel that, what? Oh, I can't do all this stuff that God says do. Amen. Praise God. How many can say amen? I know this has been challenging today, but the Lord told me to do it. And usually when I don't get much response, that's the time it's kind of getting home. Okay, but today I was just focusing on that we need to work together and join in together and support the work of the Lord and amen, and put all that you can in it, because God is going to judge you according to what you did with your time. I mean, we know probation. And how many know Jesus could come any moment? So any of us individually, your probation will be over. I mean, your faith will be already sealed. All right, so we want to get back to the Word of God and amen, and commit ourselves to things that will build us up so we can carry out the will of God. Everybody, stand on your feet. Hallelujah.